respond to a message? Well, let's think about this with an example. So here is a not very inspiring writing task, absolutely not a task from a Cambridge University Press textbook. This is rather boring. So the task is write 5 sentences using the past simple. Okay. This is definitely writing to practice language, that's clear. Seems to be one of the main aims, yeah, as people are typing in the chat. The other ones, well, yes, they have to make their own sentences. Okay, I suppose they choose what they write, so it's sort of personalised. Is it fun? Well, it might be for some people. It doesn't sound so fun. Does it involve real communication? I don't think so. So my argument would be, if we focus on making writing creative, if we're helping our students to develop their writing skills, to express themselves, and to communicate and respond to real messages, then they're going to be practicing language anyway. So let's focus on the creativity, the fun, and the real communication. All right, so first of all, we're going to talk about how to do writing in groups. And I'm going to look at a few different examples. And for each one, I will explain the activity briefly, talk about why this is could be motivating for your students, and also give a couple of examples about how you could do this online. So I've seen Yusuf say, how do we do this online? Well, I'm going to give a couple of examples as we go through for those of you that are teaching online at the moment. All right, so talking about working in groups, this is one activity you can use, and I like to call middle end. So for this, you put learners into groups, could be groups of 3 to 5. You'd set the writing task, whatever it is, whether it's a story or an email or a report, and you tell each group to write the beginning. When they've written the beginning, they move their papers to the next group. So then they read the beginning of what the first group wrote, and they continue the writing. Then finally, when they finish the middle part, they move the papers again to the next group, they read the whole piece of writing, the beginning and middle, and then they write the end. Just a couple of clarifications here. What are the other groups doing while they're waiting for the first group? Everybody is writing at the same time. So let's say you have 5 groups. Everybody in each of those 5 groups, they write that beginning. Then you move the papers on, and everybody writes the middle of a different piece of writing. And then you move the groups, the papers on again, and everybody writes the end. So everybody has written a real collaborative piece of writing. Hope that is clear. Okay, so how can we apply this for different ages? Well, here's an example with story writing. For the little ones, very simple. So the first part is the introduction of the background and the characters. So it could be one sunny day, Billy the Bunny woke up. Right, that's it. So they write the beginning and stop, they move it on. Then the next group write another event in the story. Could be anything. Billy the Bunny decided to go shopping, whatever, I'm not going to do the story now. Then they move it on, write another event, and then they move it on and write another event until you get to the end of the story. For secondary, again, it could be a story. We can do stories with secondary as well, but here's another example of another more formal piece of writing. So for an argumentative essay, everybody starts by writing the introduction. You give them the topic, I guess. Or you could get them to choose if you were doing you've got a very large class, you control the size of the groups. You don't only need to have three groups or four groups. You can have more. Okay, you can decide on the best. All right, let's go to the next activity. I'm calling this a writing round, no peeking. But some of you might know this. It was a game we used to play as teenagers called Consequences. I don't know if anybody has heard of this before. So you give the learners a question. For example, who was the man? And they write the response at the top of the paper. So for example, the man was a wizard, or the man was a very intelligent businessman. Then they fold the paper over so that their sentence can't be seen, and they pass it to the next group or the next learner. So this can be done one-on-one or in pairs or in groups. When they get the paper, they don't peek. They just listen to what you're going to ask and write the next answer. So let's say your second question is, who was the woman? They would write their answer. For example, you know, the woman was a famous film star, or the woman was a very intelligent scientist. Again, fold it over and pass it on. And they continue with you asking questions that then create a story each time they answer it, fold it over until they get to the end. And this is the best bit. I mean, of course, who else would it be? Okay, so what's good about this type of activity? It's very good for creativity, which is something we'll be talking about more later. It's often very funny. It's a fun activity. Learners can write whatever they like. They're playing with the language. It does require collaboration and speaking skills. If you get learners working in pairs or groups to write their sentences together, and they can decide what's the best thing we're going to write, and everybody's giggling and deciding. And again, we've got a shared product at the end of the day. All right, so for those two, which remember, we're talking about group writing at the moment, and I know many of you will have found solutions to doing this online already, but here are just a couple of suggestions. Students, if you're doing a live lesson like this, you could get students writing together with something like Google Docs, where they can both write on the same document at the same time. So that's a way to do group writing. Or you could put them into breakout rooms if that's appropriate for the age of your learners and if you can safely monitor them. So not suitable for the youngest learners. If your students are a bit older and you can safely monitor them, put them into breakout rooms, they write together, and then they can send you their document, and then you pass it to the next group by mailing it to them. Or if you're not doing live lessons, if you're doing this asynchronously, which many of us are, and that's a very good option, they can write at home and send it to you, and you pass it to the next student. Or you could post it on a shared website if you're using something like your institution has a website that you're using to post work, or you're using Google Classroom or Padlet or any of these tools. Again, bearing in mind safety issues and access, and making sure this is closed and only accessible for your students. All right, so we're moving to the next part, the next main dish now. And trying to make sure that our writing activities are real. Okay, so this can be a way to motivate and make writing fun. And let's look first of all at opportunity crucially, when we ask our learners to write, they write something and it's for us, right? But I'd like to suggest they can write to each other as well. We can do this in a real communicative way. And here's one example. So this paper text messages, all you need for this is paper and pens. And to do this activity, first of all, you tell the learners who their partner is. Make sure they're not sitting next to each other. So they'll be sitting in different parts of the classroom. So Ahmed over here, your partner will be Muhammad. Okay, just raise your hands. Okay, Ahmed and Muhammad, you're going to be together, but stay where you are for now. So everybody knows who their partner is. Every student has a piece of paper, and then you set the task. So they're going to write a short text message, for example, inviting a friend to their house. So they would write the text message on their piece of paper and then send it, so deliver it, to their partner. Okay? Their partner reads it and then writes a reply underneath on the same paper and then sends it back to their partner. And then they continue until you get to the end, until you've achieved your aim. So again, really simple idea, but it's real. It allows students to personalise their writing. And it's fun as well. Oh, and this is, I forgot about this. This is a lovely, got from a colleague in an online course, who said another way to do this, once they've written their message, they fold it up and make it into a paper plane, and they just fly it in the classroom, if this is okay in your classroom, and then they pick up the paper nearest to them, read that message, and then write underneath. So again, you decide if that's going to work with your students. Is it too much chaos? But that can be a fun way to start the activity off, and that makes it quite random as well to choose pairs. I can see some of you going, that's really fun. It could be a reward, it could be messy. Okay, again, yes, you decide. Putting message in a bottle, I really like that idea as well. So yeah, thank you for your suggestion there. Yeah, I'll end up picking them up from the playground, right. So just think about those things in advance before doing the variation. Okay, so we've talked about this. Why is this good? It's got real communication student to student. It does involve a bit of movement, either running after the papers or just safely and calmly delivering them. Involves reading skills as well, and importantness, it can be safely monitored. So I mean, if your students have mobile phones, you could get them sending real mobile phone messages in class, but you can't monitor or see what they're doing. So here, by getting them to write down, you can. And of course, that's suitable for primary and secondary. There's some lovely examples down here. Thank you. We've got making a paper ball and throwing your message. I saw a classroom mailbox, which is lovely. And those of you who are saying it's too much, keep it really simple. Make the task really, really simple. So it could be using the simplest of language. Hello, send. How are you? Send. Good. And you? And send, like this. All right, and an online option, again, for this activity, and I'm not talking about using mobile phones because, again, we've got some issues there about privacy and monitoring and so on, but you could do this by, they post their message on a forum, so it's public, and you can monitor this. So the first student replies to the message and asks a question, the next student replies and asks another question, and then you have a group conversation going on that everyone is involved in. And for the next one underneath, you could use the chat just as you're using now. You could get them messaging each other through the chat publicly again, so that you can monitor those. And I've just seen a question about how, what about class size? I would say for all of these activities, think about them critically and how they would work in your classes. But I would argue that this could work in any classroom. You just need to think about how they get their messages safely to each other, so they those are ideas for writing to real people inside the classroom, so writing to each other. But let's talk now about opportunities to write to real people outside the classroom. Now, a word here of caution. I was very consciously thinking about safety issues. So what I am not suggesting is students writing to random people and setting up correspondence with strangers, but looking at ways to make what they write in class have a real communicative purpose so that it speaks to real people in the outside world. And one idea that I think covers this really well, you can see it on the screen there, is a class blog or a class magazine. Okay, this is something that your students create as a class. Again, it involves group work, but it's talking to real people, a real audience, parents, the principal, people in the community, for example. So again, some of you may have done this before, but ways to do this are, first of all, to make sure students understand what this is. So a blog or a class magazine is something that your class creates that has different articles or interviews or reports or whatever they want to include. You can think of it like a class newspaper, and Hiba's saying she's done it, so wonderful. You can show them examples, so like on the previous slide, you can show them a blog from different schools that have been done, or show them a magazine or a newspaper. They think about what they want to put in it. You can use this for project work, so get them working in small groups to create their articles or their interviews or, you know, puzzles or whatever they want, to put into their magazine. And the motivating part here is that it's published. And again, depending on what's available to you in your context, this could mean handwriting it and putting it up on the wall. I've seen some people saying, yeah, we put it up in the hallway. That's a way of publishing because it's on the school walls. To the actual script. So there's different options there. And again, depending on what kind of technology and the age of your learners. I've also seen some examples here about Mr. Bean is great for for writing, you know, what's he thinking, what would he be saying? And also using puppets is a wonderful way to do drama with little kids. So thank you for those ideas. Okay, another one of my favourite games I just wanted to explain is one of these story writing games. And to do this, first of all, you need to prepare either words or pictures on slips of paper. So I've got post-it notes here, for example. Put your learners into groups. Each group chooses 5 pieces of paper. They don't look at them. They just take them and whatever they are, they keep them. And then they have to write a story that includes those 5 words. So this really encourages imagination. It can be a lot of fun. You can use it to review vocabulary or review a topic that you've been using. It can work with all kinds of different writing. You can use this for an essay, a poem, an email, a description, anything really. But you're just adding that bit of extra challenge and interest by giving them words to include. And for the last point there, one way to make this into a game is to, if they've done this in groups, before they share their story with another group, they just show them the pieces of paper, the slips of paper, the 5 slips of paper. The other group guess what the story is, and then they read the story that the students have written, and they see how close their ideas were. So again, we've got lots and lots of collaboration. And as Yenimu says there, you're teaching vocabulary and writing at the same time. Absolutely. You're activating what they know. They'll be asking you for more words and help with their language as they're writing. And hopefully, you know, they're so into the task that they forget that they're writing at all. That's what we want to happen, isn't it? So here's an example of this activity. And, you know, you can imagine a story that might include those 5 things, let's say. You know, I'm not going to ask to write it now, but it sounds like quite a mystery activity. This is the low-tech version, if you like. So this is writing things on bits of paper. And you can involve students in this. You can get them to write words and phrases and put them in the box for everyone to choose from. That's quite nice as well. Or for an online or a high-tech version, this is from a website called Wheel Decide, wheel as in car wheel. And what you can see on the screen at the moment is what to do under quarantine. But the point of this website is you can put in your own options, and when you click on the wheel, it spins, and when it stops, that's the decision. So this can be a nice way, if you make your wheel with the words and the phrases in class or in your online class, you then click spin the wheel, and wherever it stops, bing, okay, you have to use that word in your story, write it down, okay? And you do that 4 or 5 times for each group, and you take the words that way. As I say, you create your own wheel with your own words. This is just one example. This is wonderful for speaking as well, by the way, but that's another conversation. Okay, we've just got a few more to look at in creative writing. This is one of my favourite activities, is to give students a picture or a photo, or they choose a picture or a photo, talk about what they can see in the picture, and imagine how this could be part of a story or an event, and then they create a piece of writing based on it. So you can use this for, and I'm sure many, many of you are already doing this, and particularly with primary learners, is giving them a picture and imagining the story and then writing the story. But you can use it for factual writing as well. It could be to do with a newspaper report or an interview, or it could be to do with something more formal. It's completely up to you, but it's a really nice way to stimulate imagination. Oh, I love that idea. What happens when you go through the door from somebody? Really, really lovely idea. So over to you now, one more task. Here are two pictures. So we've got picture A, the helicopter, picture B, the child. I'd like you to have a look, choose one, and then just really briefly, how could you use A or B with a creative writing activity? What would you do? If you would choose B, just type B and then say what creative writing you'd ask your students to do with this. I'll give you a bit of thinking time. I'd love to see your suggestions in the chat. Actually, I can't see any suggestions, but I hope that you can. Perhaps my chat has just frozen there. Some things I was thinking, there's one from Lynette there saying something descriptive, absolutely. You could, for B, you know, write a poem about this child. You could write a description of her life. You could write, you know, what led up to this moment, for example. It could be a newspaper report, or A, again, could be a newspaper report of a rescue. It could be a script for a role play between the rescuers and the rescued, lots and lots of things that we can do there. All right, and the last thing I'd like to suggest, linked to creative writing, is to add some art in there as well, so that you can get your real people for a real communicative purpose. I've been talking for too long. And that could be people inside the classroom or outside. We've talked about creative writing to let students play with language. And we've talked about using images and video and stories to inspire students to write. So for the last thing I would like you to do is to look at these five suggestions from today and choose which number or numbers you think that you would like to do in this session. So if you're interested in doing that paper text messages, you might type in number two. If you're thinking, oh, I really like the word art ones, you might type in number four. And I'll just give you a moment to read those and type in your numbers. Right, and I think those numbers will come through as well, because there are so many people typing at the same time. I've just seen many of those ideas of pictures A and B, so thank you for all of those really lovely creative ideas. And it sounds like your classes are super already, but I hope you've got some ideas from today that you can take forward and try in the future, and your students will then hopefully be influenced a bit and will hopefully change their attitudes a little bit towards writing. Okay, so just a quick recap, this is what we've looked at today, attitudes to writing and how we can influence these. And we've looked at ways and means of making writing fun, group writing, writing for real people, creative writing games, and just finished our dessert now with what you're going to do next. So that's it. I guess this is coffee if we've just had dessert. We'll finish off if there are any questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Claire, for a wonderful hour of amazing creative activities for teachers to use with their students. What's about?
I wouldn't say it's that different from how probably you're already assessing writing, is that you're looking at particular criteria so that students know what you're looking for in their writing, and you're giving them feedback on those criteria. So for example, if you've asked them to write a poem, you need to be very clear about what you expect and how you'll be giving feedback. And that could be certainly the use of their language, but also creativity. Also, have they followed the structure in the way you wanted them to? And also, if you're asking them to decorate and use art in their poem, you could include some feedback on that as well. But I would say, however you're assessing your students' writing, is make sure you've got some response to the message of what they've written, first of all, rather than only focusing on, you know, spelling and grammar and things that often hit us first, don't they, as teachers, and we think, oh, I need to correct this and I need to correct that. But also look at holistically as well at the writing. You know, how well has this student developed since the last piece of writing they've done? What was the message? Have they been creative and so on?
Okay, great, thank you. And sort of leading on from that, another question about evaluation. If students are engaged in group writing, so the group is producing just one piece of writing, the question from somebody is, do all the members of the group get the same evaluation, even if they're producing one piece?
I think that's a good question, and that's really up to you to decide, but that's a good way to get everybody working together. And you could also give them a criteria of how well do they work as a group as part of this activity. So, you know, it's not just the piece of writing that comes out at the end, but also a part of group working and collaboration is listening, talking, negotiating and agreeing. So I like to put that into my group writing as well.
any other questions? A couple of people are asking for the name of the website, Claire, when you have the wheel, the quarantine wheel.
Oh, yeah.
What's the
wheel
website?
Decide, which is a brilliant pun. Wheel, as in the car wheel, decide.
Okay, so WHELLDECIDE, wheel,
yeah.
Decide.
Yeah, I can't type in the chat.
No, sure.
Yeah.
Okay, don't worry.
Some people have already shared the link in the chat.
Yeah, and there were a couple more links as well. There's magnetic poetry, just those two words. That's a site that I mentioned. And edu blogs for website and class blogs as well is a good one.
Okay, great. Thank you once again, Claire. That was a really exciting and engaging webinar. So thanks for all your hard work.